Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us today for the second office hours for the Reactor Cloud Skills Challenge. We have Michael, one of our principal cloud skills architects, here with us today. He is going to give us a short presentation on some DevOps, and then we will open it up for Q&As, either about the presentation or about the DevOps learning path for this Cloud Skills Challenge or the Azure Fundamentals learning path. I will be sharing some links to the both learning paths if you have not registered yet, and to the upcoming office hours in the chat window. If you have any questions, please ask so in the live event Q&A. We will publish them and then either write a response answer or Michael will answer them after the presentation. Thank you so much. And Michael, I will pass it on to you.
Great, thank you very much. So my name is Michael McKechnie. I'm a Principal Cloud Solution Architect here at Microsoft. And I'm gonna be talking today in today's office hours, the learning path of managing source control and kind of what that means for the AZ-400 learning path. So when we talk about managing source control for DevOps, really what we're gonna be talking about is GitHub. For those of you who don't know what GitHub is, it is a cloud-based source control repository. Happens to be the largest one in the world with over 40 million users. The objective of GitHub is to be very user-friendly, so it's a very low level of entry to get started. For public repositories, it is completely free. And we'll talk about what repository is in a little bit. With GitHub, you can manage your code. And then we'll go into more detail about branches, commits, and pull requests and what all those mean. You can also manage issues, create notifications, and so on. And more, very importantly for a lot of projects is the ability to create documentation. You know, what is this project for and what's it all about? So let's get into a little bit about best practices with GitHub. So GitHub.com, by the way, if you don't, if you've never heard of it before. When you're gonna get started with GitHub, first thing you do is, you know, log in, create an account. It's very straightforward, and it's free to create an account. And it's free to use for all public repositories. But the first thing you want to decide is, do I want my code to be public or private? If you want it to be public, then it is, you know, as part of an open source, which means that anybody can that goes to GitHub can search and find it. Or do you want to keep your code private? And that is kind of a decision tree that you'll make for you can make it for each repository that you create, and it's just something that'll decide you know, who can see it, who cannot. It's important to understand that GitHub is language agnostic. So whether you're a Java developer or Python or C Sharp, whatever, it doesn't matter. As a matter of fact, GitHub doesn't even really care if it's code. And we'll, as we walk through a little bit, we'll do some navigation in GitHub in a little bit. You'll see there are plenty of folks that use GitHub for other things as well, just for managing versions. One of the key best practices for GitHub is to avoid large binary files. And the reason for this, and this is where we'll talk a little bit more about Git. Git is a, you know, probably really the most popular source control versioning system in the world. And the way that it manages versions, it does it by keeping entire sections, entire files, and then comparing those files across. So as you can imagine with the binary files, which are generally very large and you really can't go inside to a binary file and do a diff on particular lines. So Git, for every time if you were to manage binary files in Git, it basically keeps an entire copy of it every single time. And it gets very, very large and cumbersome, and it will actually over time slow the system down. There is a Git large file storage system that you can use if you really want to store your binary files in the Git source control system. But it's just best practices is don't do it. Just use it for your code and the things that you need to build that code. Another best practice, and we'll talk a little bit more about this this git ignore file a little bit later on when we talk about security. The git ignore file is a file that is in the root of your directory where all your code is. Git recognizes that as a special file and reads that and says, hey, these are the file types or folders that I do not want to include. I don't want to have those committed into my source control. I don't want to keep track of them at all. And some of the things you might, are very common in a git ignore file is your bin directory, right? Where all the binaries go for your compiled code. You don't want them in there. So that would be something that you want to keep out of there. Another thing you want to keep out of there is any files that have passwords, configuration files, stuff like that, that would have passwords or other secrets in them. Those would be included in the git ignore, that those names of those files or paths to them would be included in the git ignore file so that they don't get checked in. Because as you can imagine, if you check in a password into git and then up into GitHub and it's a public repository, anybody can see it. Now that password is essentially compromised, right? So the git ignore file is very important. The next pieces are the README licensing files and the contribution files. What these are all about, this is just for people to know what your project's all about. I personally, in my GitHub projects, some are used by multiple people, others I just keep it up for my own use. I have a README file in there, even for ones that I don't expect anyone else to read, so I can remember when I go back, what is the project all about? Why do I have it here? So that is the most basic file that you're going to want to make sure you include in all of your repositories and GitHub. The license file is to let consumers of your code know what the licensing for that is. A very common one is the MIT license, which is basically an open source license that says, hey, you can use it, but it's as is, right? No warranty implied. And then if you expect to have multiple contributors, especially folks that you don't know and in the open source community contribute to your solution, the contribution file kind of provides guidelines for how to do that. So this is one of the best practices you want to think about when leveraging GitHub. And with regards to setting up your repositories and making sure that your code is going to be good and solid. Next thing I want to talk about is managing source control and branches. So Git, as I mentioned, is the most popular source control system. The concept of branching, which is common to really almost all source controls, in Git, it's a little bit different, and the fact that they're compared to some of the older source control methods, we're creating a branch really is extremely lightweight operation. Doesn't add or remove files, doesn't copy files onto your system or anything, doesn't create new directories completely populated with a new copy of the source control. It's really just a marker in the repository of, hey, here's where I want to start something new. So when working in Git, well, one of the workflows we recommend is the GitHub flow. Oops, I can go to the next file here. Here we go. Is the GitHub flow. This is all about creating branches that are short-lived, making your changes in those branches, committing often. One thing that whether you're a junior developer or a very seasoned developer, you recognize is that as you're going and you're typing away and you're doing a lot of work, you want to make sure you commit your changes to your source control pretty often, especially if you get to a point where, hey, something, it compiles and it works, commit it, right? So you have a snapshot, that is a good place that you can always go back to if you need to. If you're working all day and you don't do any commits and you realize you broke something 2 hours ago, there's nothing you can do if you didn't commit. So creating that branch comes your own private workspace. You create the commit to that often. Then you want it to go back into the main branch, the main stream that you're going to go push your code into production for. In GitHub flow, sorry, Git flow is something different. In GitHub flow, the idea is to create something called a pull request. And what a pull request is all about is to collect all those commits for that branch and present to the users in GitHub, this is what I want to commit. And what I want to do is go ahead and, while I've been talking about GitHub, I am going to go and actually show you what GitHub looks like. And we're going to go over here, pop this up. This is actually one of my personal projects, and it's going to kind of show you what this looks like. So here, github.com, here's my username, my repository that I'm in. Here's that README file. Again, very important, explains what this is all about. I only have one branch at the moment, but pull requests are all about taking a bunch of commits, right? In this case, you can kind of see here as several different commits, patching them up together and say, hey, I want to take all these as a package and I want to pull them now, hence the name pull request, into my main branch so that now can be shared by others. Because that branch was kind of my personal workspace. Now I'm going to do a pull request into that branch. As part of that, if you're working with a team, there's opportunities before that pull request gets pulled in and approved to have discussion, do code reviews, make sure that the code builds. And we'll talk about GitHub Actions toward the end. Then you can go ahead and basically approve that that pull request, and it gets merged into your main branch. Okay. All right. Go back over to this. So I talk about creating branches, doing pull requests. What's going to happen often, and especially if you're working with a large team, is conflicts. And what that means is that two people have changed two bits of code in the same file that are very close to each other, and Git says, I don't know how to go and commit these, merge these changes. So I want you to do it. I want you to do it manually. A way to avoid these is a way to make them keep them from becoming a big deal is to pull often. So you can see here in this particular section where you have this feature one branch and somebody else is working on feature two. You can see that feature one made its way into the main branch, this master branch here, while feature two is still being worked on. One of the things that you would want to do then is you'd want to pull those changes into feature two, do that merge there, avoid any, see if there's any conflicts, work those out so that when feature two gets pulled back into the master branch, you have fewer conflicts as you're going through. So it's a very common way to help avoid conflicts, but they will happen, especially when you're working with a large team. I am going to now see as we go here, I just want to make sure before I keep yammering on if we have any questions. I don't think we do. So I will just keep going.
Michael?
Yes.
There was one question. Someone asked if you can talk about GitHub Actions as well.
I sure can. Yep.
Perfect.
Let me go ahead and I'll go skip right over to that. Go back into my repository here because I actually kicked one off before this meeting. So what GitHub Actions are all about is think of it as your own build server in the cloud. As folks will often do, you'll work locally, you'll manage your commits to your local gate, you'll push them up to GitHub to make sure they're copied and kind of safe. And because it builds your machine, looks great, but the question is, will it build on somebody else's machine? And it's not always the case. So what GitHub Actions is all about is creating a clean work environment Basically, in essence, what it's happening is it's a brand new spick and span machine, virtual machine in the cloud that you can then build your code on to make sure that it's going to work, right? So there's nothing special about your computer that made it build that it won't build somewhere else. And the way you manage that is through GitHub Actions. GitHub Actions are defined through YAML, which is, you can see here, this is a YAML file for this particular build. There are some couple of key parts for the YAML file. One is the name. Okay, what am I going to call that build? This on here is when am I going to build, right? You can see I'm going to build on pushes to the master branch or the .NET standard branch here in this case, or any pull requests to the master branch. Those are what's going to kick off. Those are the events that will kick off the build. And then there's jobs. So what do you want to do? So in this case, I'm going to run it on the latest Windows version that they have in the cloud. And now I'm going to have the steps. These are all the steps that I need to run in order to do a nice clean build on a machine that has never seen my code before, right? And the great thing about this is that takes that build action, right? It puts it into a declarative code. Say, this is what I want you to do, and this is how I want you to do it. So it is repeatable, and it is in your repository. If you notice that I came across, and it's actually this YAML file is in the repository itself. So the code and the instructions of how to build it are all in there. Right. So there's multiple different steps. In this case, it's a .NET project, obviously. Do a restore, build, run some tests, and then package it up, and off we go. So the way that looks in GitHub itself is I have, this was kicked off earlier today. You can see each step is outlined here, and then I can see the full console output of all that as well, right? So I have a full record of each build, what it did, what were the steps to do it, was it successful, right, and so on. So GitHub Actions is really, really great. And they come, I believe it's on, if for a public repository, you get unlimited build minutes, right? So you can do every commit, you can just make sure it builds. That's often a prerequisite that people have for a pull request to be successful, is it builds through GitHub Actions, right? If it doesn't build, code's broken, I'm going to reject that build request until it gets fixed. Okay. Why use YAML instead of JSON for GitHub Actions? That is the language, the format of choice. So I don't know, I can't specifically speak as to why YAML was chosen. You're going to see YAML a lot more, just in general. If you're doing anything with Kubernetes, all those are in YAML as well. It's just a format that is coming up to be more popular. And I personally, would use something like Visual Studio Code or an editor like that for your YAML, because the indentations are important and so on, and an IDE or a development environment like that will help you format those nicer and make sure they work. So, see here, side question: how do I set up a sandbox on my Azure subscription similar to the sandbox provided by MS Learning? If I need to subscribe to lab services or dev test labs? I'm not quite sure what kind of sandbox you're referring to. If you're referring to the sandbox, so MS Learning, right, it does create a sandbox environment for you. It is a fully functional Azure environment. Obviously you have limited access to it, full administrative access to it, to do all the work in that lab. If you have your own Azure subscription, you could go through the the steps when you look at that in a particular lab, you know, what is it they're doing? Oh, they're building a virtual machine or an Azure App Service or whatever. You can go and build that in your research group in your own subscription if you wanted to. But I don't know that there is a specific template or anything that you would have access to. I'm not sure if that answers your question or not, but GitHub Actions are similar to Jenkins for CI/CD pipeline. GitHub Actions, yes, 100%. It actually is. You know, so there are many, many different tools out there in the world and in the DevOps world, right, for you to manage CI/CD. GitHub Actions is the GitHub version of that. Jenkins is another popular open source that has both. It's mostly on-prem. I do believe they might have a cloud offering for that as well. You know, Azure DevOps is another one that's very popular as well. In this case, for the for the AZ 400, we are focusing on GitHub for that. Let's see here. Any other questions? Actions. Okay, I don't think I see any other outstanding questions. Okay, so let me go on to continue on with the presentation, but certainly if there are any more questions, they would feel free to pop them in. Happy to be interrupt and go there. All right. So yeah, I guess the next piece I had was all about navigating GitHub. And so I want to open up a project that's a little bit bigger than my own personal projects. This is the .NET SDK open source repository, a little bit bigger than mine. And one of the things I want to show it here, talk about navigating and searching. In GitHub, there's a overall search bar up at the top, which allows you to search not only in the current repository that you're in, right? So in this case, I'm in the .NET SDK. I have the option to do in this repository or all of GitHub. And we talk all of GitHub, we're talking every public repository out there. So there's a lot there. And if I do, let's do all GitHub, kind of show you what that looks like. What the results it gives you is kind of broken down. First, by repositories, there are 61,000 repositories that mention .NET, as you can imagine. Then it breaks you down to code, you know, how many code files have it, how many commits do we have, and so on and so forth. So that was probably a bad search because there's obviously thousands and thousands of these things. But what it allows you to do is kind of see where are these things mentioned throughout all of GitHub. And you can also see too, you know, it breaks down by language. Now I did mention that GitHub is language agnostic, but what it does do is it takes a look at file extensions that it has and say, hey, if it's a .cs file, it's a C# file. If it's a Java file, it's a Java file, and so on. And so it does break down for you based on project. You can see here, this is a C# project, this is an HTML project, kind of the main language for a particular repository. So you're kind of going to see, so if you're a big JavaScript developer and you're looking for something and you find stuff in Python, you don't know Python, well, that's probably not the repository for you. Let's go in that search, let's go find one that, JavaScript is the primary language, for instance. Within this too, you have your code section, any issues, the pull requests we already took a look at actions. Here is basically the root directory, if you will, of this particular project. I want to show you down the side. There is there's the about. The about is very important, by the way. It's that one liner, two liner that tells people what this, why does this repository exist? And then the README file then becomes the, okay, I'm interested, I like what that says on the in that one liner, so let me go read more about it. If you have any releases, so if you've compiled code, you know, that one accident I had, some of the last tests were to kind of package up some code. You can have releases, and this is, you know, shows people, hey, these are, this is the versions that you want to pull down. So for instance, .NET here, you know, .NET release candidate 2, here are all the repositories, here's a source code that made up that particular release. And then you can have all, in this case, they have all the links down to the different packages to download. They also show your contributors. So who are folks that are contributing to these particular resources, and then, you know, the language makeup of the projects as well. So a couple other things you'll notice are some hyperlinks here. And these are commit messages for the last commit messages for these sections. GitHub automatically hyperlinks into pull requests, automatically into issues and so on. So as you label them, you can click into them. So I'm gonna click into that. So this is the pull request. You can get to the details of that, right? So what made up this pull request? Here's some conversations about it, right? And then what was the ultimate status of the pull request? This pull request was merged and closed out. Okay. Let's see here. You can also, you can link into the particular commits. So in GitHub, commits are given basically GUIDs. You generally refer to, instead of trying to remember all 30 some odd characters of a GUID, you generally refer to in a GitHub commit the first 6 or 8 characters. In this case, we're showing, hey, these are the files that were changed in this commit. And these are the changes. So it kind of shows you what was added, what was removed. So that's how you kind of navigate through GitHub. Okay. Let me talk a little bit about issues. So as with any project, things don't necessarily always go the way they're supposed to. You do have the ability in GitHub to track issues and comment on them. So let's go ahead and pick a random one here. That wasn't very exciting, was it? So it kind of explains what the issue is and see if I can find out. It's got some more comments on it. There you go. So this is a really good issue, right? So got a link in, follow up to a different issue. There's some code in here. There's some commenting on it. For open source projects, you can comment on yourself, right? I've done this many times, especially with a lot of the .NET stuff. You know, trying to figure out when issues are going to get fixed, when they're going to get pushed out. These are things you can ask in these as well. Okay. So I'm going to answer this question. Regarding my previous Azure Sandbox question, I suppose I would use ARM templates to build in all my resources. Yes, that would be how you could do that. Or if you are good at managing ARM templates, then that's a great way to do it. You can also go right through the portal, right? As long as you kind of understand what resources you're needing to build, you can go through the Azure portal and do a more point and click experience. There's also, you can use the Azure CLI, PowerShell. There's a bunch of different ways to build out resources in Azure. Just like the way MS Learn Sandbox is set up when I would interact and have validation checks. If you're trying to completely replicate the sandbox experience that you get out of microsoft.com/learn, there's a lot of effort put into creating those and auto-provisioning them and making sure that they have what they need and giving you the proper feedback for it. So yes, if you're going to recreate that on your own, there's going to be some effort to do that. So there's any, let me point out a couple other things here about navigation. There's 3 things up here in the corner, watch and star and fork. So a watch is, hey, I want to keep track of changes to a particular repository, right? Somebody does a commit, somebody pushes a release, I want to get notified of it. That's where a watch comes in, and you can go ahead and add a watch to it and kind of see who's watching it. And you can see I'm not watching this particular one, but I can watch, hey, I want to get notified when there's releases. I want to be notified of all conversations, which for a project this size would probably be pretty chatty. You also have the ability to star. So what a starring or repository is, just, hey, these are repositories that maybe I don't want to watch, but I want to have in a nice, easy to find list, right? So that's what that would be all about. And then forking. So in Git, you have the concept of branching, right? So you can clone a repository, which gives you the full version history for a repository. You can create branches off of that. What forking is actually duplicating a full repository, but then putting it into your own workspace, right? So it's now they're linked. They understand, you understand that this fork came from that original, right? But they're separated. And this is going to be really important. And when, say, you're working with an open source project, you do not have commit privileges to to the main piece, but you want to be able to work with it. You want to be able to do all sorts of things with it. You want to be able to commit to it. In GitHub, what you would do is you would create a fork of that repository. You now own that version of the repository. You can do whatever you want to with it. But let's say that you mean to contribute back into the original open source, right? You can then make your changes, commit them to your repository, and then create a pull request into the original. All right. So the idea of the fork is you can do what you need to do, manage that as it is your own, because it is your own, but then still has that link and just say, hey, I want to be a contributor back into the original. I can do that through the forking. So those are some of the things you can do there with that. All right, I don't see any more questions, so we'll kind of go back into the presentation a little bit. Okay, there's a concept you're gonna hear a little bit more and more often, something called intersource. And whenever I heard, when the first time I heard intersource, I'm like, why do I know that? I think, oh, interspace. So if you haven't seen Interspace, it's a very interesting movie. So intersource, not to be confused with interspace. The idea of intersource is to have that open source mindset, use open source tools and methodologies, but within an organization, right? So in GitHub, as I mentioned before, you have the concept and the ability to create private repositories. You also have the ability to create organizations, right? So I want to have an organizational place in GitHub for my folks to work and create repositories and do work inside that organization. Inside that organization, you have now that organizational control to say, hey, I want these repositories to be public, because we're going to create these as open source projects, but I want to have other repositories be private. These are going to be internal source control, our own proprietary IP and whatever. But at the same time, I want to make sure that just because I'm not, a developer is on a different team, but they might have interest in work that we're doing, right? Which is kind of how you think open source, right? I'm not on the primary management team for an open source project, but I want to be able to contribute to it. Or quite frankly, I want to make changes to code because I need them, but I don't want to have to wait for somebody else to do it. But I want to also want to contribute that back. So the inner source mindset is within an organization, allow your code to be open, just as a public open source project would be, allow folks from across the organization to be able to contribute to it, right? But then use those methodologies such as that pull request, right? To have that checkpoint that says, okay, I want to make sure that it passes code reviews, it passes quality inspections, it builds, right? The tests run, all the things, all the controls I might have before code gets into a product, or into some a process that I have, all inside this organizational element. Some of the key things, and this is true not only for InnerSource, but quite frankly, it's good for any open source project as well. Again, that README file, talked about it already before, right? What is this repository for? What is this code supposed to do? Why does it exist? README file is very important. Couple of things we didn't talk about. One is an issues template and then pull request templates as well. So I do believe in, we saw here, this one doesn't have templates. Apologize. That there are, you have the ability to create templates within within GitHub. This is, hey, when I create a new issue, these are the things that I want people to fill out, right? So it gives them guidance on how you might want to report issues and make sure that you have all the information that you need. Okay, I recently received messages. Go back to the questions. I just saw one come in. Couple come in. I recently received a message alert from GitHub regarding security vulnerabilities detected from Dependabot alerts. What do I have to do? Well, you're two slides ahead, but I'll go there anyway. So what is Dependabot? Dependabot, so go right to it now here. Dependabot is a bot within GitHub that looks at your source code and says, what external dependencies do I have in this project? Right. I saw a stat a few weeks ago. It says like 85 to 90% of coding projects use open source third party pieces. Right. And so, as you can imagine, it's a lot of different things to manage. And if you've ever used, like, if you're in the .NET world, use NuGet, for instance, right? I don't have time to review all those packages that I'm going to pull in, especially if I pull in one package which has a dependency on five others that have then themselves have dependencies on 15 others, right? I'm not going to go and review all those. I don't know what the vulnerabilities are for those. But what Dependabot does is taking intelligence from all these open source pieces. It says, okay, I know that a zip library. I got one. I don't know, probably a couple years ago. Said, hey, you're using a zip library, right? That has a known vulnerability. Oh, great. Okay, now what do I do, right? In that particular case, that library was really, really old, and there wasn't a new version for it that had that vulnerability fixed. So in that case, I needed to change the library I was using because I don't want to have vulnerable code out there. Very often, when you are, when Dependabot says, hey, version 1.4 has a vulnerability, go check and see if there's a new version out, right? Has the author of that dependency released a new version that doesn't have that vulnerability? And hopefully the answer is yes. If the answer is no, then that's where we get to, one of the things that you should have in your repositories is a security markdown file. We'll take a step back and talk about what markdown is in a second. But what the security markdown file is says, hey, if you find a security vulnerability in my code, I don't want you to put that in the issues list. Why? Because now you've just told the world this code project has a problem with security, right? Which could then, provide people with information for attack vectors on your code. The security markdown file says, hey, if you have an issue with this code, please email me here or do something else, something a more private communication channel. To go do that. So when you get a vulnerability, it says, hey, Dependabot has a problem or has detected an issue, first step is go and see if there's a newer package. Matter of fact, there are other automation bots in GitHub that can actually update them for you, which is kind of cool. In fact, I think Dependabot can actually do that for you as well. But if there are not updated versions for it, you know, contact the owner of the dependency and say, hey, are you planning on fixing this? And if the answer is no, then consider what that vulnerability is. And maybe think about working around that particular dependency, or finding another way to prevent that vulnerability from being exploited. Okay. Is user responsible for backups for their own Git repo on GitHub, or is this done automagically? So there is a So your repository is safe until you do something that is unsafe to it. And I will show you what I mean by that. Where are we going? Under settings, that's what I'm looking for here. If you go under settings, scroll all the way to the bottom of a repository that you own, there's a big red box that says danger zone. Okay. And the biggest button in the danger zone is delete this repository. So because this, you know, GitHub is a cloud, basically it's a SaaS offering, software as a service offering, right? It is GitHub's responsibility to make sure it doesn't lose your code. Okay. So the backups and the durability of that is GitHub's responsibility, right? Now, if you go ahead and say delete this repository, right, you can see right there it says once you delete this repository, there's no going back. So buyer beware, hence the big red box, the big red button. If I click that button, it's going to say, are you really sure? Type the name of it to make sure you're really sure. But once you say yes, 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 and you click it, it's gone, right? So it is GitHub's responsibility to make sure it's durable unless you click that button. Now, with regards to backups, right? Hey, how do I get back to four versions ago of my repository? Well, that's a feature of Git. Right. Git has the ability for you to go back and to look at prior versions and even kind of revert to prior versions if, you know, you're three or four commits ahead and just really, really went bad. Right. There are any integration on GitHub Actions to open source to do static code analysis, etc.? Yes, as a matter of fact, GitHub just announced, I want to see a few weeks ago, might have been a month ago, as I get older, you know, whether it was a week or a month, it's harder to tell. We now have built in static code analysis. The name of it, of the tool, top of my head, is escaping me. But yeah, there are static code analysis tools built into GitHub now. And I believe also with that announcement, there was the announcement that you can also tie in, I think, 9 or 10 other static code analysis products into your GitHub workflow as well. So yes to all those questions. All right. Okay, seeing no more, I will go back to the presentation. Okay, I'll go back a slide actually. Markdown. You'll see a lot of files. The README file had a .md extension. The security file had a .md extension. What the heck is Markdown? And I like to think of it as kind of the merging point of where human readability and computer readability meet. It was an invention of a couple of guys. I don't want to say how long ago. And the original purpose of it was to have something that was easily writable that could then be converted to HTML. And back to this README here. So here's the README file. And one thing that GitHub will do is if there is a README.md file in the root of your repository, it'll automatically show that And this is the, here's the splash page, if you will, for your repository, what it's all about. And you can kind of see it's nicely formatted. I got, the big headers, I got some lines, I got some links, and so on. But what does that really look like? Well, with any file, when you go into it, there's a concept of a raw, which is a just show me the text. Don't show me any markup, right? And you can kind of see it's a pretty plain text file, right? It's pretty readable. Make it a little bigger here for you, right? It's just a whole bunch of text, but there are some interesting characters here. There's a hashtag or pound sign. There's one of them here, but hey, wait, there's three of them here and two of them there. There's some interesting. Here's a hyperlink. I understand that, but then I got these kind of square brackets and these curved brackets. These are all that markdown format, right? This is the little bit. These are the little bits that tell the computer, tell the interpreter, I need to change the view. But at the same time, just from a readability standpoint, it's still very, very understandable, right? Unlike looking at like raw HTML, for instance, it can be with all the tags, open tags, closed tags, stuff like that, it can be very, very hard to read. The concept of the reading file is, even the raw file is very, very simple to read, but it can also then be rendered into HTML to be even kind of more formatted, if you will. So come some of the key things, these pound signs, these are header markers, the single asterisks, these are bullet points, for instance. This here is a hyperlink with a label. So the label is .NET Core build, right? And there's the hyperlink for it. Same thing with this change notes, down to the MD file. You'll see this kind of this backward apostrophe. It's that thing in the top left corner of your keyboard that you almost ever never use. It's near the tilde, right? When do we ever use that? In Markdown, that says, hey, I'm going to, this is code, right? So it's going to change the format for it. So I'll go back and show you what that looks like, right? So here's code. You can kind of see, hopefully a little bit, that it's got a little bit of a shaded background, and it's in that, that code font, it's a single space font. You have the ability to do code sections, right? So that's triple, three of those back apostrophes, one at the top, one at the bottom, designates a code section and so on. So that's the beauty of Markdown. And this is something you'll see, and it's very, very popular in a lot of these different tools, and certainly in GitHub. You use Markdown basically for all your documentation. So one thing I want to show too, I forgot about in the navigation, there's this link for whenever you look in a particular code file, there's a thing called blame. Blame sounds horrible, because there's enough blame to go around the world. But what blame is all about is really just saying, when you look at a current version of a file, and you can tell someone's been edited a lot, when was it changed and who changed it? Right, and what commit do they change it in? So you can kind of see over several years this file has been changed. You can go into the commit that the change was made in, right? And you can see the changes made to that file. So blame is just all about understanding, auditing a file, for instance, why was a change made, when was it made, and so on. That's part of the navigation. So that's what Markdown's all about. Again, it's all just all about your, all about, making sure it's readable. And it's quite frankly, it's pretty easy to write too once you get used to it. I want to show you the license file too. So very common, like I said, it's very important when you have open source code to include a license file. If not for nothing else, for your own protection, that says, hey, yes, this code is out here, it's out in the world, you're free to use it, right? The MIT license is probably the most common one. You're free to use it, free of charge, do whatever you want to with it, but in this case is as is without any warranty of any kind, right? So if something doesn't work, you know, don't come back to me. Just you know, make sure that I always make sure you include that. And it does GitHub and it recognizes, hey, there's in this license text file, it dissects and says, okay, this is the license that it's using. So you don't even really need to open up the license file when you go to a project and kind of see what the license what the license is for you. Okay. All right. No questions. I'll go back to the presentation. Okay. We already touched a little about the security markdown file, right? And we already talked about Dependabot. And I just want to highlight again, the importance of that gitignore file. Right. And that file really says, hey, these are things I don't want you to include. And if for nothing else, you know, making sure you don't include anything that has, any secrets in it, right? I'll show you what a common one looks like. It's a common gitignore file. When you create a repository, you can say, do I want to include one? This is pretty much what the default one looks like. And what it'll do, because each different development environment is going to be a little bit different. It's going to have different files that are user specific versus ones that really are code based. You can see there's kind of highlighting here different sections. So if you use Eclipse, these are files that are often files or folders. So you can kind of see that if there's this ending slash, it's going to exclude that entire folder. Or not, it's not matching a file. These are things that often are not included as part of source, right? That are usually user specific and or contain secrets, right? So these are the ones you want to exclude. For Eclipse, for Visual Studio, there's a whole bunch of them that you that it excludes, right? TeamCity, ReSharper, so very, very common things. I will often, if I'm starting from scratch, just grab a gitignore file from another project and go use it that way, right? You certainly don't create these on your own. And it doesn't matter that, hey, this is a C# project, but I have Python excludes in my ignore file. That's okay. It's not a big deal. Okay. I know we are getting a little short on time, and we'll just kind of finish it off a little bit here. Go through the last couple of pieces. Just kind of for awareness, right? So there are things in the GitHub marketplace called GitHub apps. These are pre-built and from the community that allow you to add specific workflow and automation to your repository. Dependabot is one, right? We already talked about is one of those things that you can make sure you include, and you can always build your own, right? There's called the ProBot framework that allows you to create your own workflow and automation. I would encourage you to look in the marketplace first, make sure there isn't one already there right before you go and reinvent the wheel. There's a lot of different things out there that people have done and shared with the community that make their life easier for their workflows and their own way of working. That you might be able to work into yours as well. So take the last couple minutes to talk about releasing your code, right? That's the ultimate thing you want to do. You have the ability in GitHub to kind of manage your project with project boards. Who's doing what? What are the tasks that need to be done before we do a release? We've talked about the linking, what issues are open. Hyperlink into those, hyperlink into conversations, and managing that through the boards. We already talked about the GitHub flow, right? Creating branches, you're committing in your branch, pulling in from the source branch, if as others in your team are working on things as well, to make sure you have the latest, avoid those conflicts, or at least resolve them when they're still small. Before, you know, you don't want to spend 4 months working on a branch and then pull thing and have somebody else work on their branch for 4 months and then try to merge them together. Just the amount of change is going to be really high, much more chance of conflicts that are going to be really hard to resolve. So pull in frequently. And then, you know, do those pull requests, opportunities for reviews, opportunities to make sure things are built, and so on and so forth. For there are, of course, the concept of long-lived branches, right? So if I'm releasing version 1, version 2, version 3 in my project, I want to be able to go back and fix version 2 if somebody has a problem with it later, right? And not necessarily force on. I want to be able to release a 2.1 while 3 is still out there. You'd keep 2 as a long-lived project, a long-lived branch, right? Make hot fixes into those. And then there's the concept of cherry picking. It's a Git feature where I can cherry pick a particular commit from one branch and include it into another one rather than merging everything. Right. So in the case where I need to release my, you know, I guess for a hotfix, it'd be 2.0.1, which is all the semantic versioning. If you don't know about semantic versioning, we don't have time to go into it today. But go look into that. That's how we recommend versioning things in GitHub. You know, you have the ability to kind of cherry pick that one commit that was for that hotfix in your version 2. And I want to make sure I include that in version 3, so I don't want to have a regression. I can cherry pick that and put it into version 3 and make sure it's fixed there as well. And the last thought I had was about GitHub Actions, which we've already covered, and I believe we are at time. Are there any outstanding questions?
It looks like we have a couple more. Okay. One was, is it possible that the code/files uploaded to GitHub contain viruses? Is there antivirus scanning there?
Well, remember what we talked about way back at the beginning, right? Is what do you include in your GitHub repository? You really should only include your code files, not binaries, right? So if you're uploading, you know, plain text code files, you know, then there's not going to be any viruses in your plain text code files. If you're uploading binaries, potentially, I'm not personally aware of any virus scanning during commits in GitHub, so I apologize for not nope. And next one, is there any best practice for generating dynamic config files? Does this need to live in Git? So if you're dynamically generating files, right, based on some input, unless those files would be things that you, hey, I want to have 5 different versions, you know, 5 different config files, but I just happen to be dynamically generating them. Then you can certainly commit those 5, you know, those generated files into Git. But if your application basically needs to generate a file on demand before it runs or upon install or whatever the case may be, then what would go into Git and GitHub would be the pieces and parts that create that generation, if you understand, right? So, you know, if you're dynamically generating files, some process is generating that. It's the code that you use to make that tool for generation that would go into GitHub. You'd use your action, right, to compile it and build the tool, and then you'd use that tool to generate those files, you know, at runtime or installation time or whatever. Hope that makes sense.
All right, perfect. Thank you so much, Michael. And thank you everyone for joining us today. I did put in a few links to our upcoming office hours that we have for the Cloud Skills Challenge. One will be on November 12th. That's next Thursday at the same time, 1 p.m. Pacific time. And then the final 4th one will be November 19th. So the following Thursday at the same time as well. I also included a link for our YouTube channel. You can find you'll be able to find the recording of this office hours tomorrow, and then you can also find the one for the previous office hour that we had last week. If you have any questions, please feel free to message us on Meetup. We are checking messages and the office hour event comments, and we will try to get answers for you as soon as possible. Thank you again for joining us, and we will hopefully see you all next week. Have a great day. Bye.